Father, we count it a privilege to come to you through Jesus Christ and through your word, and we are looking to you to grant us that which the anointing provides. It provides for hearing and speaking, whereby that which is commissioned by you today will find receptivity. There will be a place for your truth to not only land and reside in our hearts, but there will be that which will matter to you most, and that is the word will become flesh. So we're not just hearers of the word, but we actually become doers, and therefore are blessed, as James mentioned in his epistle. So we commit this time to you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. When we started listening to Jack and his messages on being filled with the Holy Spirit and what does it mean to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and when you first hear him, you kind of think, well, is he a charismatic Baptist? Or, you know, what is this guy? You always want to try to categorize people. And I heard him teach in a series, I think a six-part series, and he went through what is baptism, and he says that when you're born again, you're baptized in and with the Holy Spirit. And there's no other baptism after that. There's no second baptism. So he's real clear on that. But then he goes on to say, he said, now those brethren who believe in the second baptism, they often have a reality that we Baptists don't have. But we need to enter into that reality. And then he gives his testimony of how being a pastor for a number of years, and Bertha Smith asked him, Jack, are you filled with the Holy Spirit? And he kind of paused, and of course she could tell that he wasn't. And so he'd been a pastor for some 17, 18 years. He'd never been filled with the Holy Spirit. So it was through Bertha Smith and her influence in his life. She's a Baptist missionary. She was in China for 40 years, I think. She had an experience where she was filled. And it was a life of joy and power and strength and fruitfulness. And there was never any tongues or anything like that. But there was an experience of being filled. And I began to think about that. And Lori and I talked about it. And we could say that after being in BRAC a number of years, where I was ordained, when we went to Carbondale Bible Church in 1979, I believe it was, in Tulsa, we heard Major Ian Thomas speak. He spoke at lunches. We were there, and also every evening. And then we had an experience. Jesus Christ was primarily a historical figure to us. We had the doctrine, but in terms of him really being alive and being seen and made known through a human vessel, Major Thomas was the first person we ever met where we actually saw that Jesus Christ was alive. When he was up there leading the closing hymn on that Friday night, out of my bondage, arrogance, and pride, Jesus I come, Jesus I come, he was leading that. And I didn't even see him. Jesus Christ was leading the singing. It's just the man wasn't even, it was just a human vessel. So we were so impacted. And he said, you have been touched by the Lord, you come forward and just to express your faith or whatever. It's not like an altar call, you just stand up there. Lori was the first one out of her seat and was up there, and just the radiance of knowing that Jesus Christ is the life that we've been called to live as Christians. So that started us on a journey that summer of obtaining all the various messages that we could find in various sources. And I didn't have to work because I had made a lot of money in the previous job, enough money where I could live a year without working. So that's when I was in seminary. So anyway, we just listened to Major Thomas all that summer, and then we found out his itinerary, and through the years, after Morningstar, whenever he's in Tulsa or anywhere nearby, Oklahoma City or Arkansas, we would go to the weekly conferences and hear him. And then when he'd have his study week in Colorado, we would go and be there with the saints there. We went there two or three times. I went out twice to Thetis Island, to the Torchbearers, to the men's conference out there. I would say that that was really foundational for us, and we knew what it was to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We really did. It was joy unspeakable, full of glory. It was everything we learned and everything of the Lord just really became flesh. And then we began the journey with the SRA, and a lot of that became eclipsed, which is not blaming anyone, but it was necessary for the Lord to take us deeper from that which represents the individual Christ to move into the fact that the Holy Spirit is travailing to bring forth a manifestation of the Christ life on a corporate level and in a consummate level to bring this age to a close. And it was through the ministry of Austin Sparks that that whole vision of the individual Christ and it being extended and dilated into the corporate Christ, that is head and body making up the sacred secret, the mystery of the Christ, that began to be fleshed out in our lives. And we had to go down into a pit for a long time. But as we're coming out of that dark era, that which we heard and that which we've received, I believe that the Lord is going to bring us into a new place. Because if there's ever been any blessing like that at the beginning, that which comes out of that is a greater blessing. I was just reading an Eric Sauer today. Any blessing we ever had, it's just the first installment of that which is going to be exceedingly transcendent, and not only in the life to come, but even in this life. And so I'll talk a little bit more about that on what is the meaning of Jesus Christ rising as a morning star in the hearts of that prepared remnant at the end. I'll just save that for our discussion time. And so as I was listening to Jack, he taught on this passage in Ephesians. I'll just read the passage, and then I'm not going to repeat what he said. It was just very excellent. But be reading from Ephesians 5, starting verse 15 through 21. Verse 14, speaking to the carnal Laodicean church. Verse 14, for this reason, awake sleeper. And that is talking to Christians. The sleeper here is not a dead man. A dead man can't wake from a sleep. You can't exhort somebody who's dead to wake. So the evangelist will use this as an appeal to come to Christ. He is talking to Christians. Awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead. And dead means who you are as a Christian living in the natural, self-centered life. You are dead, and Christ will shine on you. Christ will shine on you. In other words, you may have him, but for him to become the light of life, as we see in John chapter 8, he who goes on following me shall have the light of life. Who shall not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Therefore, be careful. Verse 15, that is, be circumspect, look carefully on how you walk. Walk is a term that has to do with our everyday behavior and our conduct before the Lord and our fellow man and other believers. Be careful how you walk. You order your steps, your behavior, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of your time. The Greek says redeeming. You purchase the time. You buy up the time by you letting go of this, and I'm going to do this with my time. I'm going to invest in eternity. When we're on the job, we may have songs we memorize or scripture. We rehearse. We pray without ceasing. That is, we live in an attitude of constant trust and dependence and interaction with the Lord. 1 Thessalonians says, pray without ceasing. If we don't know what that means, it's because we're not filled with the Holy Spirit. Filled with the Holy Spirit, that will become more of a natural way of life. We live and breathe. Communication and communion with the Lord. So making the most of your time. Why? Because the days are evil. Do we really believe that? Do you believe that the Bible, when it says that we were once dead in trespasses and sins, Ephesians chapter 2, that everyone you meet that doesn't know Christ is on death row? Do you really believe that? Do you refer that person as a friend? If a person's on death row, is there not any responsibility we have to let them know that there's a way off death row to have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? We often have to repent of our self-centeredness or submitting to fear of not believing the Word of God, which says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Well, let's trust that that's true of each one of us. For it is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first and also the Greek. As my pastor trained us, it's not about you. It doesn't matter about how you feel at the time. You let it loose. It's like a loaded gun. If it's loaded and you pull a trigger, every time it'll fire. So the gospel is the power, the dunamis of God. So we can't be ashamed of it. So make the most of our time when we're with unbelievers, when we're living our everyday life. Why? Because the days are evil. So then, do not be foolish. Don't be morons. The Greek word is a moron. Don't be a moros. Don't be foolish. But understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. But be filled with the Holy Spirit. We'll come back to that verb in a moment. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord. Always giving thanks for all things. Always, all things. Anything less than that is unbelief. It's unbelief. Always giving thanks for all things. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to God, even the Father. And be subject to one another in the fear of Christ. Jack has a very good way in which he outlines this and teaches this passage. That verb, be filled with the Spirit. It's the word pleroo, to receive fullness. It already recognizes that there's a deficit there, and that whatever needs to be filled, there's a deficiency. So, be filled. How does one be filled with the Holy Spirit? It's a command. It's a present passive imperative, a plerao. So if it's a command, how do we obey the command? Be filled with the Holy Spirit. We have no way of knowing what that looks like. Well, these following verses talks about our walk. We step out in faith and we begin to do the word in some particular area. And so the verb, present tense, it's to be continued action, always, or continue, be, being filled with the Holy Spirit. Passive voice means that you are being acted upon. The active voice means there's a subject. In this case, the subject is God the Father through Jesus Christ. The subject is not the Holy Spirit. Go on, be being filled with the Holy Spirit. In other words, receiving, literally, fullness. Receiving, being full in and by and through the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is seen as its instrumental dative there. Well, it's also a dative of sphere. He's the sphere in which the fullness is made available, but it's understood syntactically as an instrumental. So the Holy Spirit is seen as the instrument of that fullness. The Holy Spirit, who is here as the servant of Christ in us, he's here as Jesus was the servant of the Father. Now the Holy Spirit is in us. So how do we receive fullness? That fullness comes from God, Ephesians 3:19. We are to be filled with all the fullness, the pleroma of God. Well, who's the agent to impart that fullness? The Holy Spirit. We're to attain the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, Ephesians 4:13. Well, who's the agent? The Holy Spirit is the agent and the person through whom fullness comes from God the Father through Jesus Christ to us. So what does that say about God's means to bring that about? Well, the problem is when we're born again, we're already full. We're full of ourselves. And it takes a whole lot of work in the Godhead to bring us to a place where we're empty enough where we can begin to be filled. The biggest problem God has is not sustaining the universe by the word of his power. That's simple. He speaks one word and the entire universe comes into being. Is that work? That's not work for him. Billions of galaxies? It's effortless. All the heavens is created by his word. You know what causes God to groan? In Romans chapter 8, verse 27, the Holy Spirit that's in us is groaning with groanings beyond words. Those groanings are not tongues in Romans 8:27. The groaning, the same word is used for the groaning of creation, waiting for the manifestation, revelation of the sons of God. And we who have received the first fruits of the Spirit, we do groan in ourselves, longing to receive the redemption of our body. It's suffering. The Holy Spirit is groaning to bring forth the image of Christ in us. And that's verse 29. So you have to look at the context. That's where God is working. The Holy Spirit, like it says in 1 Peter chapter 3, in the days of Noah, when the ark was being built, the long suffering of God waited. He waited until that generation was so hardened that the flood finally came. 120 years, says the long suffering of God waited. That's what it actually says. He waits, and we're very thick-headed and think we know things that we don't know anything about. Do not be drunk with wine, but go on allowing yourself to receive fullness in and by means of the Holy Spirit. Now, if our sense, Colossians 1:19, it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness, the pleroma of God, to be at home in Christ bodily, it was his pleasure. What is this fullness? It is the sum of all his divine attributes coalescing into a unified whole and an expression of that fullness. That's God as God at home in the man Christ Jesus. And when that fullness is manifested, do we see glory? We see God's satisfaction. And then Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, it says we're not to be subject to all these various teachings about Christ because he is the fullness. In him, all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily. And again, the word dwells is at home. In Christ, all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily. And then verse 10 of Colossians 2:10, and you have been brought to fullness. It says you've been made complete in him. You've been brought to fullness. That's in him. So that fullness that is ours in him, how does that become progressively more and more a reality in us? Well, we have to receive. Do not be drunk with wine, but go on being filled with the Holy Spirit. As Jack pointed out, and we studied this years ago, the Bacchanalian festivals, what the Greeks would do, and their culture in the Romans is they would have these drinking bouts, these komas, these orgies and drinking parties, and I won't go into all the details, but what they would do is they believed that they got enough wine in them, the god of wine, the Bacchus or Dionysus, would take them over, and then they would be possessed by the god of wine in a drunken state. And then in those drunken states, they would sing their praises and their songs to their gods. And we see that with Belshazzar in Daniel chapter 5, having this drunken feast, and we know what happened to him. So in contrast to this being possessed by wine and worshiping false gods and this dissipation there, verse 18. By the way, asotas comes from the word soteria, where we get the word salvation, soteriology, which is the study of salvation. Jesus is soter, he's our Savior. Soteria is salvation. Asotas, that which would be the exact opposite of being sanctified or being progressively coming into the fullness of salvation. It's translated dissipation. But instead of that, being drunk with wine, being under the influence of that which strengthens the outer man, go on be being filled with the Spirit. Are there any clues, are there any references in Ephesians that would help us understand what our part is to walk in such a way that we're redeeming the time? So I want to go back and have us look at Ephesians 4:17. The goal is the whole body would be built up until it attains the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. We're to grow up into Christ with reference to all things. That is the goal. Ephesians 4:7-16. Each member as a joint of supply and according to the measure in which they're functioning in fullness and in that spiritual gift, we're to be contributing and building up the body of Christ in love. That's verse 16. This I say therefore, Ephesians 4:17, and affirm together with the Lord. Affirm together in the Greek means to solemnly bear testimony. I understand pagan culture. I am a Greek. It's my background. I live in this culture. I know what you're all facing in this pagan culture. I solemnly testify together with the Lord that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk in the futility of their mind. The word futility means they're always to be striving after something, always wanting to attain something would fulfill, whether drugs or whether sex or whether something in your business. There's always a seeking after a fulfillment, and it never pans out. It's mataiotes, it's emptiness, it's futility, it's vainglory. The futility of their mind. Being darkened, that means reaching a state of darkness in their understanding, alienated from the life of God. Now, why would he be saying this to believers? Because believers can revert back to a pagan lifestyle. They can revert. Baptists call it backsliding. Okay? He's speaking to Christians here, alienated from the life of God. When a person's living in carnality or outside the will of God, you're alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them, referring to the unbelieving Gentiles. We're not to go back and fall back into that state because of the hardness of their heart, the petrification of the heart. What a disastrous state to be in. And they, having become callous, in other words, the conscience is seared, as Paul says in 1 Timothy chapter 4, and there's no longer a sensitivity. You know, what leprosy is the nerves die off, they don't have any feeling anymore. And they can injure themselves and they lose limbs and everything because there's no feeling. There's no sensitivity. So there's a state in which apostasy can lead to where you're past the capacity to have any spiritual sensitivity anymore. It's a hardened heart, having become callous. He's talking about unbelievers and warning Christians not to walk in this way of life anymore, having given themselves over to sensuality. Sensuality has to do with all the sins of the flesh, and it's always, 100% of the time in the New Testament, having to do with some form of sexual sin, illicit sexual activity. For the practice of every kind of impurity, again, that has to do with illicit sexual activity, with greediness, that asalgeia, as Dr. Barclay says, is the ugliest word in the Greek language. It means a greed to possess something, to take for yourself with utter disregard of how that would affect the other person, this as long as you can glut and satisfy your own lust. Everyone that's still practicing ritual activity is involved with this. this lust, greed. But you did not learn Christ in this way. You did not learn Christ. We can learn about Christ. We can agree. And that's still not learning Christ. Learning Christ is the person becomes the person in our life. The person becomes the governing reality of who we are and who we are becoming. In other words, if you learn Christ and others are with you, then you're going to say, you know, that person is different. Instead of someone who has learned about Christ and they can exhort you and quote scripture and there's no authority there because their lives are not being changed. I don't want to be in that category. I absolutely do not. I have too much of a history of already knowing what that is. And you did not learn a person in that way. That is, walking in a manner as the Gentiles walk, verse 17. You didn't learn Christ that way. Learning Christ, the person. If indeed, that is assuming indeed you have heard him. Not heard about him. You've actually heard him. How do you hear him? He's a person who is alive in you in the person of the Holy Spirit. You actually have a conscience, an intuitive response to what pleases him and what does not please him. You become more and more sensitive to what pleases him. For me, as I go on with the Lord, I become more acutely aware if I offend the Holy Spirit just by the way I answer my wife. Just tone of voice. It's either representing a disposition of Christ. The Spirit of Christ, pneuma, means a disposition. It means an attitude. It's spirit, but it is that which conveys our innermost essence. If you've heard him and been taught in him, that's the work of the Holy Spirit. To teach us in him who is the sphere of our life. Taught in him. He's the sphere. Or we could say taught in him because we're in abiding union with him. Just as truth, ultimate reality, is in Jesus. So if you're talking to somebody and their life is all screwed up and messed up in some way, and you're trying to show mercy or love and grace to them, if they're not walking in truth, that grace isn't going to go there. You can talk about love, grace, and wonderfulness of Jesus, and if they're not walking in truth, there's no place for it to go. They got to repent of the deception of not being in submission to Jesus Christ, who is the truth. Truth and righteousness are found together in the Bible. You're not going to find grace and mercy going to anyone who's not walking in the truth. You're not going to find it. It's not going to be there. If it is there, it's because God is seeking to woo them, but it cannot go there in fullness until there's repentance. Repentance means we have a change of attitude that says, God, you're the truth. I am not only imperfect, but I am infinitely dense and stupid compared to who you are and your infinite holiness and you're omniscient. And so therefore, I repent of any action or assumption that I have about anything or anyone that is not aligned with your truth. Taught in him, just as truth, aletheia, means absolute reality is in Jesus. The reality isn't in us. The ultimate reality isn't in somebody else. It's in Jesus. And the measure in which we see Jesus in others, when he's being made known in and through us, then that reality becomes in Jesus. Just as truth is in Jesus. Notice it isn't about him. It isn't necessarily he's the source, although he is all those things. It's in him. So if we're walking in him, Jesus, the title of his humanity, then we will be walking in the truth. That in reference to your former manner of life, that is what we are by nature before new birth, that with reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old man. You put off as an old, corrupt, worn out, filthy garment, the old man. What we are by nature is filthy and it's dead to God. Not just sins, even the natural man. Even what we are by nature, even the good in us. Remember the tree that's in the garden, the tree of knowledge of good and evil? That good is just as filthy as the evil, because it's dead to God. Notice, it doesn't say the trees of good and evil in the garden. It's not two trees. It's the tree singular of good and evil. It's the Hegelian dialectic. It's the yin and yang, the light and dark. It has one root. That one root is in man apart from God. All that we are by nature apart from God. Everything in us that represents our heritage in Adam. Jesus Christ is the last Adam. He came and took on our nature without any personal sin. He was born without a sin nature. He lived this life in perfect obedience to the Father. And as man, he went to the cross, and as the last Adam, he took within himself the whole of the race in Adam, as Tom Smale says in Good Confession. He died on the cross corporately and collectively as the victim and the victimizer. Perpetrator, the sinner and the one sinned against. All the offenses, every offense that man has experienced from fellow man, it all is ultimately an offense to God. Like David says in Psalm 51, when he's confessing his sin of murdering Uriah. By the way, Psalm 51 doesn't even talk about it, the sin of adultery with Bathsheba. It's blood guiltiness, which there's no sacrifice for. There's no offering for that. He says, against thee and thee only have I sinned and done evil in your sight. Didn't you sin against your people as a king when you did what you did? Did you sin against Uriah when you had him killed? Didn't you sin against Bathsheba? He says, against you and you only have I sinned and done that which is evil in your sight. So our sins do affect others, but they first and foremost affect God. And so when Jesus is on the cross, he took that within himself. That whole behavior, notice, lay aside as an old worn out garment, literally, the old man. There's only one old man, and his name is Adam. And the characteristics of that old man is called flesh. And the root of flesh in the old man is sin in the singular. We know in Romans that God's solution for sin is not the blood, but God's provision for sin is the cross. The cross is where the sin is dealt with. Blood deals with sins, making a way for forgiveness, and the cross takes away the root, which is the source of sins, plural, by crucifying it and taking it to death with Christ. You have put on the new self. So the imagery here is that baptism is the symbolic way of viewing what happened to you when you put your faith in Jesus Christ. And when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit baptized you into Christ, and simultaneously Christ baptized you in with the Holy Spirit. So there's two baptizing subjects. A new birth, the Holy Spirit baptizes us into Christ, and simultaneously Christ baptizes us in or with the Holy Spirit. You can go through all the verses on that. It's not two baptisms. It's looking at the one baptism, Ephesians 4:6, from different angles. And when we're baptized by way of testimony in the water, we see what we are in Adam. We go into the water of death. We are plunged into the waters of death. We go into death and see ourselves as one with Christ in his death. And in that death, we disappear. That old man is gone. And then we come up out of the water. That old man is not there. The old man is now clothed with Christ. The old clothes, the garments, will put off in death. And now, according to Galatians chapter 3, we're now clothed with Christ. Christ is our new covering. He is our righteousness. We put off the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit. I was reminded that we say the old man is covered in Christ. I think a better way to say that is that Christ is the last Adam. When he, on that cross, is baptized and goes into death, he takes us with him into death. And so the Christ that covers that or takes that into death, it's not so much a covering, it's an identification. So what he is as Jesus, as the last Adam, that's his schema. He is truly man. His outward form is Adam, but his inner essence, he's still in the form of God. That's Philippians 2:5 through 9. He's morphe to theou. He is in the form of God. As schema in the outer man, the old man, which he became identified with, as he goes into the water of death, in death that garment is stripped off and it remains in the grave. Okay? If we put off the old man, it means we are saying yes to what has already happened when Jesus is the last Adam, went to the cross, was identified with us as the last Adam, and he dies, and we die with him, and he goes into death, we go into death, that's the waters, that's baptism. And when we come out of the water, that's the picture of him coming out of the tomb as the head of a new creation. When Jesus came out of the tomb, there was nothing of the old Adam there. As the last Adam, eschatos Adam, means it's the end. There's no repeat. There's no successor. Adam is terminated, never to come up again or seen in the eyes of God. Romans 6 says, he died with Christ, buried, gone. God does not see that old flesh in terms of our identity in Christ. If we're going to go on being filled with the Holy Spirit, then in terms of our action, if we are expressing that outer garment of the old nature, then we need to put that off. That's our responsibility. You can't say, oh God, I can't deal with this old man. Well, if by the Spirit we're putting to death the deeds of the flesh, we shall live. If we are doing that, then life will come. If by the Spirit we're putting to death the deeds of the flesh, you shall live. He says, you put aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit. Notice, the old man that is still very active in us, whereas in Christ he's dead, we're responsible to put off the old. Go on allowing yourself to receive fullness by the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is there to help us and to empower us to put to death the deeds of the flesh. Let me just read that passage in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. I say, walk by the Spirit. Galatians 5:16. Present imperative. Walk by or in. He's the sphere in which we live and move or have our being. Instrumental, it is by the Spirit. And you know what the Greek will allow? You could say, walk by the Spirit. That is your human spirit governing your soul, because the human spirit is one with the Holy Spirit. There's no way to know in the Greek, but we know that the Holy Spirit is the one that empowers, but it must be governing our mind, emotion, will, our soul, through our human spirit that has been released from death through the circumcision of the heart. We won't be able to get that today, but the scripture talks about removing the foreskin of your heart. It actually says it. Some of your translations don't have it, but it's very graphic. There is the outer man that has to be removed in order for the inner man to come into ascendancy. So the inner man is the spiritual man. I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and for these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that literally you may wish. That's what we see in Romans 7:7 and following. That dilemma there. This is not just the carnal things, this is just what we are by nature as well. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law, because the law incites sin, it provokes sin, it defines sin as sin, so that it becomes the power of sin. When the law is our ruler, we know from 1 Corinthians 15, the strength of sin, the power of sin, is the law. And then he goes on to say, if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident. These are the attributes of the old man. This is what sin is. Flesh defines what sin in the singular is. Then there's the fruit of the Spirit, verse 22. Verse 24, those who belong to Christ Jesus. Now, this is very interesting in the Greek. Those who are of Christ Jesus. How do we understand that? Well, my translation, New American, they take the genitive as a possessive genitive. The grammar just says those who are of Christ Jesus. So how do we understand the genitive? Is it possessive? Yeah, that includes that. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. It's complexive. In other words, those who are deriving and are allowing themselves to be defined by Christ Jesus do something. Jesus said, I didn't come to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. I only and always do those things that please my Father. It's derivative. And the genitive case is a case of definition. If Christ is one who defines us, because yes, we do belong to him, he is the source of that which in the Holy Spirit that gives us the ability to crucify the flesh. Now, have crucified is aorist tense. Translators have done the best they can, and they take an aorist tense and they translate this as a historic tense, that is, as a fact accomplished. And that is true, but that's not the basic meaning of an aorist. You could have put this in the perfect tense, which Paul does in Galatians 2:20. But what is the aorist? The aorist is the only tense that doesn't tell you when something happened. Most verbs tell you when something happened. Either something is happening in the past, or did happen in the past, something is happening in the present, something will happen in the future, something that happened in the past but is completed and has abiding results, like the perfect tense. Aorist doesn't tell you anything about when it happens. The aorist states a fact that something did, does, or will happen. When I was reading this in Dana and Mante, which is a Greek grammar, they cited this passage as a gnomic use of the aorist. Gnomic means it's a principle. It doesn't tell you about time. It emphasizes the fact. So how would we translate this? And this is how Dana and Mante translates this. Those who belong to Christ, that is, we are defined by Him. He is the subject and source of who we are and genuine possession. Yes, we do belong to Him. We do crucify the flesh. That's what we do. We do. We say, yes, on that cross 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ took our place. We take our place and we say, yes, every day. I forget how Bertha Smith puts it, but every time she wakes up in the morning, she agrees with what God says. I, and what I am, as the old Bertha, what I am by nature, I am dead. And I'm only alive unto God in Christ Jesus. You begin every day. Agreeing and affirming the truth of God's word. So those who belong to Christ do crucify. Do. Aorist tense. Do. Gnomic aorist. Stating a fact. This is a way of life. Do crucify the flesh with its passions and desires. And if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk. Only this is not peripateo. We're to walk in Him, peripateo. This is stoicheo. This means we live an ordered life. A Spirit-filled life is ordered. It has disciplines. This is used of military soldiers who are in rank. They stay in rank. So the Holy Spirit has us in our place, and we are in step with God. We are yoked with Jesus Christ, and we're walking in His steps, as it says in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6. Let us not become boastful and challenging one another. So going back to Ephesians chapter 4, putting off the old. Remember, that's the old Adamic way of life. That's the flesh, the Galatians 5. The works of the flesh are manifest, and we can see that in Galatians 5 and other places in the Bible, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit. In other words, that sin nature that we have never changes, never gets better, is never reformed. We step out of abiding union with Christ, this is always true. There's that corruption that's there. Whatever our particular bent is, that never changes. There's never any improvement. And Bertha Smith, she has that little, was it red man and black man thing with her panel. She puts those little things up there, and you're covered with Christ and His righteousness. And then after all these years, you're a wonderful preacher, or you're this and that and the other. And then you begin to be really proud and how good you are and all that. And she pulls back that thing. Who's behind there? The preacher's just the same. He hasn't changed at all. If that flesh comes out, everything's just the same. There's no improvement. And you know what the problem is with most of us? Is that every time the old man sticks his head up out of that grave, we get shocked. I think it's really a sign of spiritual growth, and we're no longer shocked. We're no longer shocked by the fact that our sin nature never acts any differently. In fact, if we're growing in the Lord, it seems to get worse. It hasn't changed at all. But the closer we get to the Lord, the more we're conformed to His image, the more aware we are of just how bad it is. And progressively, as we're growing up in Him with reference to all things, it appears that if we're in the flesh, we're getting worse. We're not getting worse. The old man is the old man. He's dead, crucified. The good and the bad. Remember the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Good and evil. One tree. One tree. What's good? That's humanism. I can live my life independent of God. That's Laodicea. I'm rich and I have need of nothing. And there's no sin there at Laodicea. Not one sin is mentioned when Jesus indicts the church of Laodicea. He doesn't mention one sin. Nothing of carnality like we see at Thyatira, Jezebel and her children, and all the carnal activity there. It's the good. I am rich and I have need of nothing. The religious, the natural man. You see? And Jesus on the outside knocking. And the people of the church of Laodicea are very busy. They've got these big mega churches, and they're just having this wonderful time. And they don't even know that Jesus is not the source of their activity. He's outside. That's the predominant characteristic of the church at the end. And of Christians at the end. Jesus Christ is not their indwelling, living source of who they are and what they're doing. That's Laodicea. But in contrast to being subject to that old humanity and the lusts of deceit, remember, Satan comes to tempt and wants this to put on a kind of picture. Moses said, the pleasures of sin, which are just temporary, sin has pleasure, but they're deceit. Why? They end up in futility, verse 17. Emptiness. Never, ever fulfilled. goes on to say, but that you go on, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. The spirit of your mind. In other words, the renewal of the mind requires that the human spirit, in union with the Holy Spirit, comes to dominate the mind through the Word of God. Like it says in Colossians chapter 3, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly with all wisdom and understanding. The Word of Christ. And I find, if I neglect the Word in any way, it doesn't take long before you begin to see a deterioration in your spiritual life. So be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Renewed is ananoel. It means our mind needs to be renewed, but it needs to be under the government of not the natural life, the soul life, but under the dominion of a human spirit that's been released from that outer shell, the outer man, and come under the government of the Holy Spirit. And that human spirit emancipated through a progressive union with Christ in his death, through circumcision of the heart, as the outer man is being corrupted, which is dying daily, then there's the gradual ascendancy of the spiritual man, the human spirit in union with the Holy Spirit in union with Christ. That you be go on being renewed. Present infinity. Infinity means its purpose. It's God's purpose. You go on be renewed in the spirit of your mind and have put on the new man. So that's something we do. We are conscious that, well, I'm in this situation. I'm very irritated. I'm very provoked right now. Naturally, I would act out this way. I would say this. And so I need to choose to deny myself, pick up my cross and deny myself and die and put on the new man. This is how Christ behaves. And I am consciously in dependence upon you for that fruit to be manifested. And it doesn't mean that you feel anything. It is an act of the will. These imperatives here, put on the new man, it is a choice of the will. It is not an emotion. You don't wait to feel a thing. So if we're going to go on being filled with the Holy Spirit, this precedes, notice chapter 4 precedes chapter 5. If we're going to go on being filled with the Holy Spirit, all this precedes. How about chapter 4 verse 1? Walk in a manner worthy of your calling. Well, what is your calling? Christian, what is your calling? Well, that's Ephesians 1 through 3. Governed by purpose, and as Dermot Fromke said, who's the source of that purpose? Whose pleasure is that purpose revealed? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavens in Christ. It's Father-centered. Father-centered. I remember when I was studying the Word, and I was listening to a message by Ralph Braun in Oregon, when we went out there for a time for seminary training, preparation, and he said, it's rather strange that we have all these ologies in systematic theology. We have the theology, theos, God, ology, the study of God, theology, soteriology, soteria, salvation, the study of salvation, harmartiology, harmartia, sin, the study of sin, anthropology, the study of man, pneumatology, the study of the spirit, Christology, the study of Christ. Why is there not patternology? I never forget that question. Why do we not have a systematic study of patternology, the study of God as Father? It's missing. I look at my theology, and it's not there. So what happened? Well, Jesus came to reveal the Father, and when we pray, Jesus says, you pray to the Father, if you ask the Father anything in my name. So the point is, Father. So we have a Father-centered purpose. And if we are living in that purpose, and we're going to be putting on that humanity that is the new creation identity that is there for the pleasure of the Father, that lives in a spirit-filled life that exemplifies Jesus Christ. For me, it's like, oh, I hear this, I'm speaking to myself. It's like, I've been a Christian 40-some years now, I don't know how long it's been, well, since I was 11, but I didn't begin to follow the Lord until I was in my early 20s. So however long that is, it's like new. As I started reading today, I got up very early. I was reading In the Arena of Faith by Eric Sauer. That's like there's a whole new vista out ahead. I mean, there's all new territory for me, personally. It's all new. And even though I've heard about it before, the actual stepping into, being clothed with Christ in a new way, is a whole new prospect. And I think the prospect is not only true of our spirit, or what our inner man, but our soul would come more and more into alignment with our spiritual man, our inner man. And looking to the Lord, there would be an overflow into our physical bodies. If our spirit is more in union with the Lord, which it is at new birth, but The Spirit needs to be sanctified, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1, which means the Spirit can be defiled, not just the soul, but the Spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. It refers to our spirit. The Spirit can be sanctified, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. So as that's happening, then that will affect our mind and our emotions, our will. And then as the body comes into the sanctifying effects of the soul, then I would think that there would be something that would demonstrate the testimony of Jesus in a way that would reverse some of those things that the enemy would bring in to cut our journey short. I mean, he's there to cut us short. He is a murderer. He's actually the first murderer. Jesus came that we might have life and have it abundantly, but the thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. But I, Jesus said, came that you might have life, that's new birth, and then have it abundantly. If we're going to be walking in the newness of the Spirit, we need to put on the new humanity, which, I don't know what your translation has there, but it's very interesting in the original. It's katatantheon. It means according to God. But that preposition kata plus the accusative of God means God is the ultimate standard. He's the norm. He defines everything. And so this new humanity is according to God. When God created Adam, he created Adam in his own image and his likeness. Okay? Now, image, that's the inner essence. If we are to display what God is like. That's image, that's masculine in the Hebrew. Very interesting. He created man in his own image according to his damut, his likeness. That's feminine. So for us to be complete, we have that which is masculine and feminine. Men have more of the masculine, but they also have a certain representation of sensibility and feminine nature of God, whereas the woman is dominant in that. But think of that. Image, it's inherent, that's essentially what God intended man to be. Likeness would be a manifestation, would be a subjective manifestation. We'd say today, if there's likeness, that's the testimony of Jesus. There's likeness. When Adam sinned, then that image is still there. There's still intellect, there's still will, but it's marred. It never attained to the goal that God had intended. Adam was created initially according to God as the standard, but he was undeveloped and untested. Jesus is the last Adam. He took all of that which God intended for the first Adam, he took it all the way through to sanctification, to absolute perfection, and then on the cross became the sacrifice. But he has accomplished everything that fulfills the standard of God for man. It says, this new man. What is this new man? Ephesians 2:15. Christ is the first man that was born sinless. Adam was created sinless. But Jesus is the first man born without a sin nature. Now that's very interesting because we're all born dead in trespasses and sins. Adam was first created as son of God, I think last verse of Luke 3. He's created sinless, but he sins. And then all of his progeny, Genesis 5, 1 and 2, they come forth in the image of Adam. Jesus is begotten of God, and now a new birth. We are begotten of God in the begotten one. He is begotten by the Holy Spirit. And he's begotten again from the dead in those two begettings, in that humanity, which is perfected. And then when he's raised from the dead, he's begotten from the dead. He's the firstborn from the dead. At new birth, all of that becomes true of us in our new birth identity. So there's only one new man. Christ is the head, and his body corporate is his body. It's called the body of Christ. That's the one new man. When it says, when they translate, put on the new self, that means, well, you have a new self and I have a new self. That's not true. It's all singular. The old man is singular. There's only one old man, of which we are all partakers. And there's only one new man. And Christ, Ephesians 2, verse 15, he is the head of that new humanity. That in himself he might create from the two, Jew and Gentile, one new man establishing peace. One new man. That's the new man we put on. And the new man has attributes, and those attributes and characteristics referred to as the fruit of the Spirit, that which demonstrates the nature and character of Jesus Christ. Notice this new man has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. If we are putting off the old, we're putting off anything that's unrighteous. We are putting out of our life anything that does not represent holiness that is governed by truth. Holiness of the truth. Holiness of the truth. Righteousness, which is the revealed will of God in thought, word, and deed, means my life becomes more and more upright before the Lord. It's right. My life is right. And holiness of the truth. That's the new man. We put that on. We're responsible to do that. And the Holy Spirit is there so that we, in dependence upon Him, we say, Lord, this is impossible. I can't do this. I can't love this person. I can't do this. You want me to work with this person? I can't do it. I really can't. I say it all the time. I mean, yeah, I can't tell you how many times somebody wants to do a Skype or whatever like that. I just said, I can't do this anymore. I just can't do it. And I just sit down and pray, and I just say, okay, Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I'm not here to do my will. I'm here to do your will. I step in, and things always happen. They always do. Something always happens. And not that I'm surprised, but I'm always relieved. You know what I mean? I mean, you're relieved that something happened, because if you're reckoning according to yourself, as Eric Ludi says, if you're reckoning what you have in your pockets, it can be pretty bleak. So we're just shut up to faith. This new humanity, notice, has been created. When was this new humanity created? At the very moment Christ was raised from the dead. That corporate new man came into being at the very resurrection of Jesus Christ. So that in the resurrection, 1 Corinthians 15:47, Jesus Christ is begotten from the dead, and he's now head of the new man. And 1 Corinthians 15:47, that new man is referred to as the second man. Second man. We put on the second man. We have the old man, that's the first man, and we put on the second man, which is created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. Well, that will lead us to taking another look at circumcision. Now, we're not going to do that now, but trust the Lord for this for Wednesday. Wednesday, we'll visit again Colossians 2:11-15. As a teaser, when Jesus Christ, as the last Adam, was identified with the whole race in Adam, and on that cross, he was not only judged for our sins and shedding his blood, that is, releasing his life as a propitiation of the Father through death, that's the blood, poured out his soul into death, but he also died as man for man, representatively, and in who he was as the last Adam, on that cross, when he died, the old man was put off, corporately. In the circumcision of Christ, the putting off of the flesh in the body of Christ. So the whole picture of circumcision, which is a Jewish sign of the covenant, so this covenant was enacted when Jesus Christ died on the cross, but that whole corporate identity of what we are by nature in Adam was removed in the circumcision of Christ. All that is gone. And we will look at what that means. And if we're walking in covenant loyalty to God and walking in the fullness of new covenant, that means we not only circumcise our hearts, but if we are walking in dependence upon Him and in submission to Him and picking up our cross and denying ourselves and following Him, He circumcises our heart. We're going to see that we're to circumcise our own hearts. Deuteronomy 30, I think, verse 6 or so, God will circumcise our hearts if we do certain things. So as we're putting off the old and putting on the new, God is faithful to take that which is true in Christ, and we'll look at it where it says that we have been identified in the circumcision of Christ. And what happens? The outer man is taken into death, and the inner man, the new man, is coming into manifestation more and more and progressively in our everyday life. Father, we acknowledge that we're like infants. We can hear these things. But as far as putting on the Lord Jesus Christ and making no provision for the flesh, as your word says, I think in Romans 13:15, we just have a long ways to go. And so we look to you, Father, to lead us into the fullness of the blessing of the Christ, as Paul referred to his anticipated coming to Rome. He was confident that when he came to Rome, he would come in the fullness of the blessing of the Christ. May that become more and more true of us, wherever we are, on our jobs, in our homes, that we might be walking out the fullness of the blessing of thee, Christ. And like you promised Abraham, in you, Abraham, your seed, all the nations will be blessed, and I will make you a blessing. So may we come into the fact that we've already been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavens in Christ. we want to become a channel and a manifestation of every spiritual blessing that heaven is in Christ to one another, but first to you and to those that are dying without Christ. A blessing by being the truth and proclaiming the truth of the gospel. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.